All right, good morning. I call to order the April 26th Saline County Commission Public Forum and Meeting to order. Would everybody stand and join me in a flag salute and a moment of silence?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Will the clerk call the roll?
Commissioner Shadwick?
Here.
Commissioner Guile?
Here.
Commissioner Price?
Here.
Commissioner Larson?
Here.
And note, Commissioner Smith is absent today.
Move next to the public forum where citizens may speak on county government, usually limited to 3 minutes. Is there anyone that would like to come forward at this time? Good morning.
Morning. My name is Alan Lindholm. I live at 3647 South Lightville Road. My wife and I have lived out there for 38 years. My concern is the road between West Waterwell Road from Burma to Lightville. When we first moved there, it was a good, solid country road. Over the years, this road has completely deteriorated. When we first moved out there, the only time it was impassable was when we had snow and it drifted. Now, during the 38 years, it's deteriorated so bad. We had the military driving that road for almost 20 years with tanks and equipment to go out to the city. Now, I believe that was a lot of the deterioration of the road because of the heavy loads. Recently, many companies have been coming out and digging trenches and throwing dirt up onto the road. The two recent ones was HCI and AT&T. And I think that had a lot to do with deterioration. A year ago, county crew came out and they put many loads of dirt on the road. And I think it was to elevate the road and try to get some drainage, but we really don't have any ditches on that road. But they didn't put rock on it right away. So on Saturday, we had a slow rain and they had to close the road. It got so bad. And a week ago, we had the same thing happen with that rain. And I'm sure a lot of the county roads were bad, but ours became to where it was impassable again. The county did not close it until they came out to repair it, but it was practically impassable to get through. I know my car is still packed underneath and the front wheels are shaking because of mud and you can't get it out. Mr. Nash and I have had many emails back and forth, and I emailed Lucy about my concern. And we have quite a few people that live out there, the Knollcrest Edition, and then we have the West Slope Edition, which was added a couple of years ago. And the traffic count, the last traffic count that I got was 650 a day on that road, which is pretty high. Mrs. Nash's consensus to me in an email was that that road needs to be reconstructed or it needs to be paved. What I'm asking you today is to consider allocating funds to get that road fixed up so that we people of Knollcrest and West Slope can get in and out of our houses. We had, after 2 days or 3 days, we had to go way out of the way to get in and out of our homes.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we've all been out there on the last couple of days, and that's a tough road.
Yeah.
And you're talking to us at the appropriate time. We're just started the budget process this morning. And we'll continue that tomorrow. So we'll take your opinion to heart. So thank you for coming by. Anybody else would like to come forward this morning?
Ray Huska, 235 North Santa Fe. Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
Dave Smith hasn't attended a meeting here for how many meetings has it been? 4 or 5 meetings? I'm concerned that he's not representing his district properly. And I just wanted to point that fact out, that I don't know where he went or how long much longer he's going to be gone. Do you have any input about that?
My indications are next week, but I have not talked to him, no.
Where did he go?
I don't know. He didn't disclose to us.
Okay, so, thank you.
All right. Anybody else would like to come forward?
Karen Shade, 111 Wisconsin. In the budget processes that you've begun, I was glad to hear that Don Merriman was offering to schedule an opportunity to look at new voting machines. And the public is very interested, and they appreciate that you included that. And they might just need a lot of time, as much notice as possible. But I know the League of Women Voters is one group that is very concerned about this issue. So including them on that would be great. I do want to speak to at the sheriff's office with the jail to reduce the number of inmates. I believe it was in March, 77% of the inmates, Captain Melander said, were waiting for trial. So that does speak to a need for a possible courtroom, an additional courtroom, and you're just getting into the process. And to me, that seems to be an integral part of that committee's work. I'd also like to speak to, it's become commonplace for you to discuss the differences with the sheriff and the budget as, well, that's just the way it's been. He's always, that department is frequently overspent, those kind of things. That isn't acceptable from the citizen's standpoint. Yes, there will likely be a new sheriff. That new sheriff may very likely be someone who's been trained by the present sheriff. And the way of not budgeting things to different line items so that others can have oversight and some of that is really frustrating. And it speaks to a problem that if the public were fully aware of how much is overspent, a half $1 million this last year, the year before, perhaps that again, those are mill levies roughly. And, you know, because nothing has been put in place to stop it, it's just another mill levy the next year. So taxes could have been reduced, perhaps, or other needs could have been met. So I would just strongly advocate that people, you have a meeting scheduled tomorrow at 8:30 on the budget. I see that as highly important that people go through it. I observed it last year. There's a logical procedure that's used. You get to the results that become the budget in an easy to understand way, but people really do need to be involved. Thank you.
Karen, with the Sheriff's Department, it isn't logical because we cannot stop that spending. It comes as an emergency thing, and we have no say over it. If we did have, and I think that's where maybe the you were talking about
and
senators and legislators.
I was
going to
mention that as
things.
Well. A lot of the costs are uncontrollable. In other words, the medical, the transporting of the inmates at any given time, we are over capacity over at the jail, which I'm sure you know that. Even though we're going to have a new sheriff in town, he's probably going to have the old
problems.
Sheriff problems as well.
Right.
But I do welcome the new sheriff's ideas and possibly creativity and how to answer that $64 million question. But yeah, a lot of it is, as you well know, is you can't control those that spending. So yeah, it's a difficult
but
situation.
In some ways I disagree. You as a commission have the ability to look at the overtime costs. You had a discussion today about that, whether personnel wages or working conditions or whatever are satisfactory enough to create enough interest in working there. And that would overtime is a big chunk of things that these people can't be unsupervised.
And we can't do that.
Another concern, especially if Dave Smith were here, he frequently scrolls up on his phone and says, look, six of the seven people in the booking report are here on parole violations. And it's the parole violations piece that have got people saying, well, it's not a violent offense. We don't know if they're reoffending. We don't know what those issues are. But last week was the only meeting of the jail committee I haven't attended, and there really haven't been good ideas brought forth. And in the magazine Governing, from 2014 to 2018, it lists a statistic that Kansas population or inmate population, prison population is only going to go up by 1%. But the state facilities are full, and they are pushing back people to the counties. And I think there's some things that really need to be looked at there. As I've tuned into the issue, I hear other communities are dealing with this as well. We need to be proactive. We need to be doing more, because the money we spend today, because we just don't know what else to do, is that much more, it's kind of squandered until we find solutions.
Well, and with all due respect, Karen, I think that committee has been working very hard at this. They have met regularly, and it wasn't going to be a situation that was going to be solved overnight.
Right.
They have literally only been at this a few months, and I think it's going to take the members that they have on that board to help with all the data, all the research. They're coming from different walks of life, of course, with the guidance of one of our commissioners and community corrections. I think Annie Grievous is also on that committee as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to happen overnight, and so I beg to differ. They have been working very hard on this and meeting regularly until they can get that wheel fully spoked and turning.
But this became an issue in 2010 and up through the election cycle. The jail overcrowding has been in place for
Well, it finally took this year for Commissioner Smith to say, let's do something about it. And evidently, due to his perseverance, here we go.
We've been talking about that ever since for years, haven't we? I mean, and we were talking about it before we got in. It's nothing new. It's nothing new at all.
It's nothing new, well, but the lack of solutions, the lack of being able to control the finances is something that I think voters need to look very seriously at,
mm-hmm.
and maybe make some decisions into as to who they place to be,
mm-hmm.
involved with this.
And I look constantly at our people that are getting in jail, and a lot of them don't have driver's license. Okay, let them drive and get drunk and kill somebody, and then they're better off than being in jail. I don't know the solution, but I know there's people that need to be in jail too. So
correct. It's just the standard is, why are we experiencing something so much higher than what I will bring to you the governing magazine. I'll have that for you tomorrow to back up my statistics.
All right, thank you. Anyone else would like to come forward at this time? Seeing none, I'll move on to regular business. Item number one.
It's the approval of the agenda for the public forum as presented today.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve the agenda for the public forum as presented.
I second that.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Passes 4-0. Item number two.
Approval of County Commission minutes for April 19, 2016.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the County Commission minutes of April 19th, 2016 presented.
I'll second that.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Passes 4-0.
Aye.
Item number three.
Have a good day today for a couple people here. Rick Lamer will be presenting two Oliver Hague scholarships. It's request for action 141-16. Rick Lamer, Livestock and Expo Director.
Morning, Rick.
Good morning, sir. Just a brief history of the Oliver Scott Hague Scholarship. In 1991, the late Oliver Hague donated 1,100 acres to Saline County. It was Oliver's wish that the land be used for farming and ag-related education. Proceeds from leasing the land will fund 12 $1,000 scholarships for Saline County students in 2016. Our scholarship committee met in early April, and today we are proud to announce this year's recipients, Weston Jennings and Kyler Sewer.
Well, first of all, I'd just like to start off by saying thank you for everyone involved in this scholarship. And I'm Wes Jennings. I'm a senior at Salina Central, and I will be attending Kansas State University in the fall and majoring in agronomy.
Very good. What are your plans after graduation, do you think? It's a long ways away. I know.
Yeah.
I understand. It's a hard question.
I think one of the things I'd like to do is come back and work for a local ag business, or maybe like even get a job for a local farmer as an agronomist or something like that. So
right.
I think that'd be really cool.
Very good. Go Mustangs.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Kyler Sewer, I'd like to say thank you also. I'm a senior at Southeast of Saline. I'll be going to Fort Hays State University and majoring in agriculture.
Your plans after college, do you know?
I'd like to get a rangeland management degree so I can come back and help farmers with their rangeland operations.
We'd love to have both of you back, so thank you. Very worthy scholarship recipients. And first of all, let's do an action, and then I'll present you with their certificate.
Can I say something real quick?
Absolutely. Sure.
Oliver Hagg did that 25 years ago. Maybe we ought to have this is a 25th year. Maybe we ought to bring a proclamation to that. What he did, he is really, I've probably seen 8 people get this scholarship since I've been on, or 10, and it really is a great that Oliver Hagg did this for you guys, and we really appreciate that mm-hmm. scholarship fund.
Mm-hmm. Good point.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve RFA 141-16 and award the 2 Oliver Hagg scholarships to Mr. Wesley Jennings and Mr. Kyler Soar.
I second that.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Passes 4-0. Rick, would you like to get a picture with them? Do you want me in this? Or? Hey, don't get my sandals.
You're wearing sandals?
I didn't. A little hurry this morning, so.
Congratulations again.
Item number 4.
Proclamation declaring May 2016 as Older Americans Month. We have Leslie Eichelberry here. She's the Executive Director of Commission on Aging.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thank
Good
you
morning.
For having me here. Appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, for the last 4 years now, I believe we have celebrated Older Americans Month. It's actually a national observance, but at the Senior Center, we've been observing it for about 4 years now. We have a variety of additional activities in addition to what we normally do. Fun things, get people involved, bring people into the building, that kind of thing. So. The proclamation. Whereas Saline County includes a large population of older citizens who deserve recognition for their contributions to our community and nation, and whereas Saline County recognizes that older adults are trailblazers, advocating for themselves, their peers, and their communities, paving the way for future generations, and whereas the Saline County Commission on Aging was established by County Commission Resolution on March 12, 1974 to provide needed services for senior citizens in Saline County, and whereas the Saline County Commission on Aging is committed to raising awareness about issues facing older Americans and providing a variety of services and activities to Saline County seniors, and whereas the Saline County Commission on Aging can help ensure that community members of all ages benefit from contributions and experiences of older adults. Now, therefore, we, the Board of County Commissioners of Saline County, Kansas, do hereby proclaim May 2016 to be Older Americans Month and urge every resident to take time this month to acknowledge older adults and the people who serve them for their contributions to our community.
Very good. And I'm looking at the everything that's
the
happening.
Schedule.
It's
yes.
just amazing.
Yes, we have quite a few things. If
what
I can.
What are your most well attended events?
Anything with food.
Lunch.
Seriously.
Lunch.
Any of the lunches.
What's on the menu today, by the way?
Yeah.
I knew somebody was going to ask. We have chicken stir fry or patty melt, rice beets, fresh fruit or fortune cookie or salad bar. The Painter's Showcase on May 6th probably will be very well attended. We do that as a part of Art Rush, and so we get quite a few people who normally wouldn't be in the building who are going to all the Art Rush events. We're hoping that the medical equipment drive on the 7th picks up a little bit. We did it for the first time last year, and what we do is we collect walkers, canes, wheelchairs, things like that, that we, you know, if they need to be cleaned, we clean them up. And then we loan them out to seniors who can't afford to buy their own. we started it last year visiting with somebody from the hospital rehab unit who had done that in another town. And she said, you know, the first year, not so many mm-hmm. people participated, but each year it grew. So I'm hoping we outgrow the room that we store that stuff in, because there are a lot of seniors that need things and they just can't afford it. So we're hoping that picks up. The treasure hunt's really popular. We're going to start that on May 9th. What I do is I hide something in the building, and we do a new clue every day. And I'm the only one who knows. I don't tell my staff because people try to, you know, hey, can you tell me where it is? And I thought I was being really clever last year. I hid it on the elevator so I could have clues from all three floors, and somebody found it in 3 days. So I've got to be a little more clever this time. But a lot of people participate in that. The building tour is something new. We're doing that in conjunction with the library class program this year. And I haven't heard latest numbers, but on the first day that people could register for the spring classes, we had already met our minimum for that one. So I think that'll be a big one for us. And, you know, that we're letting people come in and observe and participate in the exercise classes. That usually brings in quite a few people. Hoping the one that we're doing for line dancing will as well. So.
Well, the diversity of events is quite impressive, and I'm looking at two of them here that I can see being very important. May 11th, the Protect Yourself Against Scams uh-huh. presentation. And uh-huh. I hope some people come to that.
I hope they do,
so
too.
I also, you know, all the wellness fair is not a once-a-year thing. I mean, you do that a lot, and so.
Yeah, and we don't have all of the details on that one yet, but Brookdale has some new things that they can do, some testing and things, so.
Are you able to text Commissioner Price anytime you have liver and onions? Or
I get it.
Know,
I get
or does
it.
He
I get
know?
It. No, I get it.
I was going to say, every week we have to hear about how fantastic the food is there.
Well, good.
For the cost.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And Commissioner Price, I think, is one of your biggest fans.
Yes, he is.
He says that there's nutrition in it, as well as, of course, the dessert sometimes may not be so nutritious.
But you guys
got to have a little fun with a little work.
Exactly.
And good company.
Yes. And that is the one thing I wanted to point out, especially to people watching us at home today, is that anyone can come. I mean, it isn't just for senior citizens.
Right.
It's open to the public.
The lunches.
All ages welcomed. Usually the lunches are about $4.50.
Mm-hmm.
And my favorite already for May is the one on Cinco de Mayo. Don't know if we'll be back yet from Manhattan yet, Rita, but somewhere I'm going to have to go on Cinco de Mayo and have my celebrated lunch there.
Alrighty. Thank you.
All right. We need action. And
Mr. Chairman, I move that we declare May of 2016 as Old Americans Month.
And I'm an old American, so
older.
I second it.
Older.
Older. The word's experienced, you know.
There you go.
Experienced.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Passes 4-0. I have your signed proclamation here. Would you like that, right?
Yes.
Thank you for everything you do there.
Thank you. Nice to see you, Leslie.
Item number 5.
We have a resolution 16-2197. It's Planning and Zoning Commission reappointments, and have David Neal, Planning and Zoning Director, here.
Good morning, David.
Morning, Commissioners. Before I start, I always want to put this out. We still have, this is just reappointing commissioners that are currently serving on the board. This would be their second term. But I always want to point out for anybody out there that we are still looking for more planning commissioners. If you're interested, we have expression of interest forms in room 217, or we have those online. And that goes not only for the planning commission, that goes for any of the county boards. We can always get some more volunteers out there. And I'll just make it easy and read the resolution. If you have questions, go ahead. The resolution reappointing Leslie Barron and Tom Rickstrew to a 3-year term on the Saline County Planning and Zoning Commission. Whereas pursuant to KSA 12744B, the Board of County Commissioners of Saline County, Kansas is authorized to appoint members to the Planning and Zoning Commission. And whereas the Saline County Planning and Zoning Commission will have 2 expired terms and 2 vacant seats. And whereas the above-named members have expressed interest in serving the citizens of Saline County as a member of the Planning and Zoning Commission, and whereas the potential reappointment of members was discussed at a public meeting held on April 19th, 2016, Now therefore be it resolved that Leslie Barrett and Tom Rickstrew be appointed to serve on the Saline County Planning and Zoning Commission for a 3-year term that will begin on April 26, 2016 and expire on March 31st, 2019.
All right, very good. Questions? And this gets you to enough people until we can maybe find some others.
Correct. With the Planning Commission, we have to have at least 5 people, so we will have that, and we have to have the balance that the majority live in the unincorporated area.
Very good.
And that makes sure we maintain those things.
So the other ones that are coming in need to live in the county, is that correct? Or
you could have one city, one county,
well,
but you can't have two
left.
Cities.
Correct. With the 2 empty seats, I currently have, if you reappoint the members that are up for reappointment right now, I would have 4 members that are in the unincorporated area and 3 members in the incorporated area, which would mean with the new seats, the first one coming in would have to be unincorporated. The second one could be
either. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Good.
And I kind of came, somebody, a citizen called me the other day and said, hey, so-and-so would make a good, so I'm going to contact him. I mean, get a hold of us if you're interested, and we'll talk to you about it.
Sometimes people just need an invitation,
if we know
of someone.
And they don't realize that they serve. I told him he wanted to know how much time it takes. I says it's usually once a month. It may not be for every other month. A few hours. It's right now. The last couple of years, things have been pretty simple, haven't they?
We usually, the Planning Commission will meet when there's a case for them to review. I want to say we meet about, it's once a month, like you said,
right.
The first Monday of the month at 7 o'clock at night.
Mm-hmm.
It'll last 2-3 hours. We try to get through
right.
everything as fast as possible because we all want to go home that late at night. And I think we met maybe 6 or 7 times in the last year.
So it's not a difficult.
No.
Committee to be on. Some people think it's a lot tougher than it is, and it really isn't that bad. So
very important one to also.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, is there any public comments? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve resolution number 16-2197, Planning and Zoning Commission reappointments of Leslie Barrett and Tom Rickstrew to serve on the Saline County Planning and Zoning Commission for a 3-year term, beginning April 26th of 2016 and expiring March 31st of 2019.
I'll second that.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Passes 4-0. Item number 6.
This is resolution 16-2198 for the Board of Zoning Appeals reappointments, and it's also a request for action 149-16.
The same thing again. We're reappointing some members that are already on the board. We do have a vacant seat on that board, too, so if you're interested, bring in those expression of interest, and I always say it's not just the boards I'm talking about. There are a lot of other boards out there that can always use help. I'll just read off the resolution and do the same thing. Resolution reappointing Janice Morris, Kirk Kusick, Tom Rickstrew, and Kevin Watts to a 3-year term on the Saline County Board of Zoning Appeals. Whereas pursuant to KSA 12-759, the Board of County Commissioners of Saline County is authorized to appoint members to the Saline County Board of Zoning Appeals, and whereas the Saline County Board of Zoning Appeals currently has 1 vacant term and 4 expired terms, and whereas the above-named members have expressed interest in serving the citizens of Saline County as a member of the Board of Zoning Appeals, and whereas the potential reappointment of the members was discussed at a public meeting held on April 19, 2016, now therefore be it resolved that Janice Morris, Kirk Kusick, Tom Rickstrew, and Kevin Watts be reappointed to serve on the Saline County Board of Zoning Appeals for a 3-year term that will begin April 26, 2016 and expire on March 31st, 2019.
Very good. Questions?
Again, on this one, you have 1 empty, and that can be city incorporated or unincorporated?
Correct.
Okay.
Again, we have to keep the balance, but at this point, if you reappoint everybody, we would have 5 that are unincorporated members and 1 that is an incorporated member.
And you do allow them serving on both of them, because we've got a couple of them that are doing that right now.
We're allowed to have 1 member that serves on the Planning Commission as well as the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Oh, so you've met that quota then, so you cannot
correct.
Now be on both.
Correct. Tom
okay.
Rickstrew is the only one we have doing that.
Okay.
Right. Public comment? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve RFA 149-16 and approve resolution 16-2198, the Board of Zoning Appeals reappointments of Janice Morris, Kirk Kusick, and Tom Rickstrew, and Kevin Watts to serve on the Saline County Board of Zoning Appeals for a three-year term beginning on April 26th of 2016 and expiring on March 31st of 2019.
I second that.
It's been a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes 4-0. Thank you very much.
And just last call, expression of interest, talk to your commissioners,
yep.
Stop by room 217. We have the form online.
Very good. Thank you.
Thanks.
Item number 7.
We have an RFA 143-16. It's a bid award for the Waterwell Road Bridge project number 15-5323. They have Neil Cable here, our county engineer, to give you a report on that.
Good morning.
Good morning, commissioners. I just first wanted to point out that Road and Bridge Director Gary Nash is also on the agenda, but with the weather that's everybody knows is coming this evening, there's a meeting over an emergency management starting right now, actually, that he's attending to coordinate Road and Bridge's efforts with emergency management.
Very
so that's
good. That's yeah. Thank you. Thanks.
Yeah, I think that's probably more important than being here. okay, this item for your consideration is to discuss and take appropriate action on a Saline County Road and Bridge Department request to award a contract for the furnishing of all materials, equipment, and labor, and doing all the work, whatever kind necessary, to construct a concrete haunched slab bridge. We opened sealed bids on April 11th for project 15-5323, which is the construction of a three-span. The spans are 54 feet, 72 feet, and 54 feet. Concrete haunch slab bridge to replace the existing deteriorated and also load-rated triple barrel corrugated steel multi-plate drainage structure located on Waterwell Road, 4/10 mile west of Powers Road. Four companies submitted bids, and their bids plus the engineer's estimates are indicated in the table there on your request for action. I can read those, or just the low bidder?
Just low bidder.
Okay. King Construction was the low bidder. King Construction out of Heston, Kansas. And their bid was for $596,374. And they set a start date as July 15th of this year, and finishing that in January of next year. The engineer's estimate was $700,345.25, and so it's less than the engineer's estimate, and so a contract can be awarded according to state statutes. So the alternatives for action today are to accept the staff recommendation, reject all bids and rebid or other options, and then the staff recommendation is to award a contract for $596,374 to King Construction Company for the construction of the three-span concrete haunch slab bridge to replace the existing deteriorated corrugated steel multi-plate structure out there currently. The budget impact, the funds would come from Fund 125, which is also called the 2-mil account, and that's a Road and Bridge special bridge construction account. The account currently has an unencumbered balance of $764,909.64, and if the Board of County Commissioners elects to award a contract, there would be a remaining amount of $168,535 left in that account at this time. So
questions?
Mr. Cable, the only thing I noticed is that they were the only ones that were going to start in the summer, where all the other ones were in the fall.
Correct.
I realize that the difference to the next bidder was less than $10,000, but is that a problem because of it being summer and harvest? And
no.
Is it going to be closed for the duration of that time?
Harvest will be before that. In fact, our specifications, we don't allow them to start construction during harvest. Obviously, there's a fall harvest too, and you can't completely,
right.
You know, once you got to start sometime, you know.
Right, I know.
But the main wheat harvest, we don't.
Well, hopefully we'll be over, yeah.
Yes, it by July, it, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
All right, further questions? We've used this company before.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
King has built
numerous
bridges, and I have some comparative costs. It's a little bit higher per square foot is how we compare the bridge costs. A little bit higher than the Most recent comparable bridge was our Wyman Bridge. This one's a little bit higher, but there's a lot more earthwork involved.
Okay.
So it's pretty understandable. It's still an excellent bid for that large. It's a 180-foot long bridge. So
right. Yep. Very good. All right. We have any public comment? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we award the bid for the Waterwell Road Bridge Project 15-5-3-23 to King Construction Company Incorporated in the amount of $596,374.
I'll second that.
It's a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes 4-0. Item number 8.
We have a RFA 142-16. It's a bid award for actually a hot mix patching, leveling and surface course, and profile milling. And that's project number 16-5335. And again, report by Neil Cable.
This item for your consideration is to discuss and take appropriate action on a Saline County Road and Bridge Department request to award a contract for the furnishing of all tools, equipment, and labor required to provide countywide hot mix patching, leveling, surface course, and profile milling. And this work is to be done at the locations stipulated there in your request for action. I can read through them all if you want, but probably not. Getting the reaction.
The public is interested,
it'll be
on the website.
We opened bids on this project 16-5335 on April 11th. And again, the list of sites that were selected for this year are included there. All the work is to be completed by November 18th, which is pretty much the end of hot mix asphalt paving season anyhow. We received two bids, one from APAC Kansas Shears Division, the other from Schilling Construction Company out of Manhattan. And APAC Kansas was a low bidder at $1,756,808.60, and that was less than the engineer's estimate of $1,844,000. And we did review the bids and check all their math and verified that. So the alternatives for action are to accept the bids as indicated in the staff recommendation, reject bids and rebid, or other options as the commission sees fit. Staff recommends awarding a contract for project 16-5335, hot mix patching, leveling, surface course, and profile milling to APAC Kansas for $1,756,808.60. And the budget impact, this comes out of Department 30, which is Road and Bridge, the account set for asphalt work. We've already awarded one contract, as you'll recall, for the crack sealing, which is well underway, actually. They're out there today for $91,930. So if the commission elects to award this contract, we'll have $78,231.40 left in that asphalt account, should other issues, as typically
as
does.
Yeah, as
not many years it doesn't, things kind of explode after our harvest, but
right.
Yeah.
Well, the scope of this project is amazing, $1.7 million.
Yeah,
so
it's a big job. A
lot of great things happening here.
Yeah,
is that typical or what we've
yeah,
been spending lately?
Pretty
that's
much.
What we do.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'd just like to point out, I mean, just, you know, we've got two items on the agenda today totaling $2.3 million.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
You know, we do the best we can and do with the money that we can. And
yeah, and there's some.
It's just tough to keep up.
Yeah.
It just is.
Yeah, when you got expensive
right.
infrastructure,
right.
I mean the annual investment in it is a fraction of the cost of the value of the infrastructure.
Right.
So it's kind of amazing what it costs to take care of stuff.
It does. And Commissioner Guile, remind us how many miles we have.
Oh gosh, 251 of the hard service miles, right? Isn't that something like that?
Something on that order.
Yeah.
1,100 to
And we've done, there's times we've done 23, 24 miles a
yeah.
year.
Yeah.
But one question here, Neil.
Sure.
On this Donemeyer Road from Country Club to Okay, that's that deal that they did not finish last year.
Yes, sir. That's
okay.
we're
but
coming
that's
back
all
with
included.
Yeah. I mean, that's one of the projects in there is to do a surface overlay on that Don Meyer Road section, and we're rebuilding the section up there next to Elsling School, grade school there where all the bus traffic is, which really is in desperate need of rebuilding. So there's a lot of good work in there.
Yeah. But you know what I'm talking about on that one.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
All right.
Do we have any public comment? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chairman, I move that regarding RFA number 142-16 that we award the bid for the asphalt milling project number 165335 to APAC Kansas Inc. in the amount of $1,756,808.60.
I'll second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
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 That passes 4-0.
Did you get who seconded that? Was it the same time, Don?
Did
you pick one?
And don't let me do it.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Neil.
And by the way, you know, we really discussed a lot about spending money on that road today, and the commissioners are concerned about it, all five of us. And we are looking at funds and where we need to put them in our budget. And so we thank you for coming today. And we've been hearing from everything. And we've heard it for a lot of years, haven't we, Jim? And,
yeah, we
and we know there's a need out there. And that's probably one of the top three, if not the top road on our list. So.
Well, if I can add, I had 36 emails, and I could not respond to all of them. The first couple ones that kind of hit, I was able to respond to them right away, and then, boom, one day I just had, like, 20. So I had 36 emails I counted regarding that road, 4 phone calls. I tried to respond to as many as I could, but what I did do, because I invited you to come today to the meeting, and I knew we were going to be discussing, start budget discussions upstairs this morning, and then I knew we were going to have this discussion today. I responded, I did send a quick email out to everybody and told them about this, and so I'm very glad that you came. No fault to the others. I don't know if their jobs prevented them from attending here today, so I think you speak on behalf of all your neighbors over there. And we do know it's as Commissioner Price mentioned, we do know it can get very dangerous. And of course, safety, that's why the road was closed, because I think they were looking at the safety. And until they could fix it and it dried up a little bit, then they reopened it back up. So thank you for bringing it to the forefront again. It's been on the agenda for a long time. We know that that's a rough piece of road right there. So we're gonna see what we can do.
And another thing too, we had set aside $800,000 towards blacktop roads, and they were kind of applying that to get some work done to maybe building a new road and bridge building. And this commission's decision has been to repair the building, and we'll have that money back to be able to use for one of these three roads that are really in dire need. And so we're heading the right direction.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Item number 9.
Community Corrections Update with Annie Grievous, Director of Community Corrections.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is for February and March. Average daily population in February is 499, 39 cases assigned, 17 closed, total of 555 served. In March, it was 492, average daily population 21 assigned, 28 closed, for a population served of 541. The board met March 24th. The Community Corrections Office primary business was a director's report to update agency statistics. Cody Sparks from Mental Health Center was our guest speaker, and he presented on youth crisis services and a new housing option for the youths in crisis that's being developed, and information regarding services that in general the Mental Health Center. There was a lot of discussion among the board, concerns regarding services and medication options, and just delay in services, and gratefulness that the options are getting open for youth, because youth don't have a lot of mental health services locally. So those are increasing, it looks like, and that's a good thing, especially since those youth will be in our community more than they've ever been. I presented the behavioral health grant application already to DOC at this point. It's a result of the $3 million being allocated across the state of Kansas for community corrections to apply for substance and mental health programming. We asked for $40,000 additional dollars from the previous year. I've been in front of you. You've approved this grant already, but when I wrote this, you hadn't. It includes three staff, a contractual CKF person. Then the remaining dollars are used for funding of clients, both traditional ISP and drug court clients, detox, inpatient treatment, traditional transitional housing, which is recovery housing for long-term addicts that need stable residence. The most expensive services are those three things I just mentioned. A detox and inpatient treatment is $180 a day. And they're utilized most frequently by the clients. Board reviewed the grant and did approve it. It has been in front of the Saline County Commission, and those grants are already at the DOC. The next board meeting at the time when I wrote this was April 21st. The next board meeting is actually May 5th. We're working on some grants, and I didn't have some statistical information and some salary information in time to present it all by that date. So we are meeting May 5th at the Community Corrections Office at noon, and then I'm meeting the following week with County Commission to get those grants approved to be forwarded to the Department of Corrections. The subcommittee met on February 16th and March 22nd. It's always an update on agency happenings, a review of any new initiatives at local or state levels, and agency and client statistics. The next advisory board already met subcommittee on April 12th at 11 o'clock. Community corrections issues, behavioral health grant wasn't due till May 13th, but we got it done and it's there now. I'm working on the largest adult grant right now to the Department of Corrections. It includes salary and benefits of all adult programming staff, not outside of the other grants that are already funded. And that's five staff. Five staff don't even fall into this grant, and it's one of our largest grants. Drug court funds other staff, and so does our behavioral health grant. We were notified previously they were, again, a reduction of $45,000. We spoke about that much earlier when I told you I had a position open, and I just was not going to fill that position. So that takes care of every cent plus a little bit more. So good, effective practices make okay, because you're not laying off staff or cutting services, so we're going to be fine coming into FY17. Update on FY16 outcomes, just to give you an idea. These are in the grant, but the agency is on track to meet all our outcomes that we proposed in our last year's grant. We're doing a significant reduction in revocations to Kansas prisons, and we're seeing an increase in successful client completing probation. That's not just because of community corrections. It's a result of drug court and other options that we've been awarded throughout the years. It's also because of the behavioral health funds. The agency is a 72% success rate. When you think about the client population we serve, high risk, high need, highly addicted substance abuse, mentally ill clients, and we're serving at a 72% success rate, that's amazing to me. We were always in the 60s for years. And for us, over the last couple of years, to get up into those 70s is commendable for my staff and the programming and people that help us provide services with funding to do that. We'd like to reach 75%. That is our goal. I don't know if we're going to make it in these next couple of months. We have until into June. It could happen. It looks like it might happen. But if I jinx myself, then I'll be ticked. So can I say that word, ticked? Okay. So I'm not going to do that. Don can change that too. She'll be quite upset if he wants to. That's all right.
Access will have to bleep you.
Anyways, we're going to focus on the 75%, but I'm still very delighted and want to praise my staff and the programming and drug court and all those things that we do and work so hard at every day to have client success. So I do want to say that. Additionally, we are more accessible to treatment services than we've ever been. We are increasing the clients employed, and drug court continues to rock it with graduates. We're at 41 graduates since the inception and 153 referrals, and it's just amazing. It's a program that you can't argue about. We're also attending KDOC meetings in Topeka recently over new law changes and different things, and we've met with legislators in different sessions, and it's grant season, so I'm kind of busy in that phase right now. Under the juvenile services, we've talked about Senate Bill 367 a few times. I have not specifically outlined details to you. I'm happy to at some point, not today, but at some point, it passed overwhelmingly, and basically the result of that bill is juveniles will not be placed in lockdown facilities or high risk, need costly programming. Those youth are instead are going to be serviced in our local community. It'll involve court services and community corrections working together and coordinating efforts. It'll start at our juvenile intake and assessment process, and we've recently had some discussion about our juvenile intake and assessment and how we've increased those efforts and beefed up those services. There'll be more diversion programs. There'll be more services for these youth. We'll be addressing youth and their families inside their homes. It's a complete change from what we're used to. We've always removed children from the home if they are unable to function there and put them in facilities. Lots have gone to detention, and those days are over. Slim County will have a significant reduction in detention bed space utilized, and I think I can speak for Judge Sorrell when I say she is not going to utilize detention unless they're violent or sex offenders and have to be locked down, and she will not be using what we call YRC2s, which are intensive therapeutic homes for people or facilities. We're going to service them in our community, which, if you read the evidence and you've done any research, and I have, and so has Judge Thrower, they're not gaining anything when they go to detention centers, or they're not gaining enough. They're not coming back changed individuals. They're not coming back, they're repeating their same behaviors and going back multiple times. Research tells you that you can treat them and serve them in the community with a lot of the programming we've talked over the years about, cognitive-based therapy, in-house home services, working with the parent and the child together and not separating them and making them two entities. You've got to bring them together and work them together to keep that child in the home. Those are the things we're going to do. My staff and I are meeting with Judge Thrower May 4th. We've already put together an entire plan to remove all the youth that are in facilities now and the reentry efforts and how we're going to work with them in the community. So those youth will be removed within the next month or less. In addition to that, we've developed and talked about programming we'd like to see at the front end, diversion programs, different services that are not in existence now that we think can. We also want to utilize a lot of the community providers. I've gotten many, many calls from community providers want to be a part of this new bill and this new action, which is exciting that community isn't just walking away and throwing their hands up and saying it's not our problem. They want to be a part of this. So I'm excited about it all. I'm speaking faster and faster probably to show my excitement, so you can place that on that. So we meet with Judge on May 4th. At some point after that, we'll meet with Ellen Mitchell to talk about who gets placed in diversion and how those policies want to be written from her update. And then I hope to have a community resource meeting to update them and let them know where we are in the process and those kind of things. We'll continue to work with court services, Judge Thrower, and the county attorney's office to move this through. I think that the biggest thing is that it's a complete change. I'll keep you posted as we move along, and so you're aware of where our Saline County youth are and what's going to be happening with them. I only have to add one person to the advisory board because we have an excellent advisory board, and I've always been delighted with what we have. I have to get a defense attorney on there, and I already got one that said they would join, so that's taken care of. We also have to form a multidisciplinary team, and that'll be a portion of our board members. I just have to get the input and seek them out. So we are, what I would say, is probably on top of this bill as well as any county district can be, and ready to move forward. I meet with you later this afternoon to get a signature on some assurances. Because everything's changing and everybody at the state levels have to make changes due to this bill, they're not going to send out a grant yet and have you do an application. They're going to just fund you half 6 months of what you got last year in funding. We just have to have board chair, commissioner chair sign off on the assurances that we want that money to function for the next 6 months until they figure out new funding sources or new funding methods. Miscellaneous drug court staff, and I hope Judge Johnson, are going to be presenting in Manhattan at the County Commission Association on May 4th. I don't know if I mentioned that was my birthday, but it is my birthday. It's really going to be great. I know I can just sense it already. We're going to use updated PowerPoint and updated statistics, and each staff and the judge will present on evidence-based programming and our successes. And like I said, we were honored to be asked. I looked at the agenda. We look like one of the best programs on the agenda, so I know you're all going to be there and excited to hear us speak. And it'll really be great if we can get Judge Johnson out of a jury trial in there. So keep your fingers crossed for that one. And then we talked about this one time. In-house staff is providing all the intake and assessment now. We're not using contractual staff anymore. It is working fabulously. Our staff are fully trained. I've had no issues at all, and I couldn't be more happy with the decision we made.
I'm always amazed at your updates, how much you're able to get done. So
thank you.
So thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Any other questions or comments?
My mother had her own special program. It was called Go Get a Green Switch, Meet Me in the Bathroom at the Clothes Hamper.
Well,
and I can still remember those days. I still remember those days, and it was very, and she says, I should have done it more.
Okay, I'm going to play no comment on that. Thank you.
So, but anyway, those, I remember those days.
I'm sure you do. I mean, I lived in the days, too, where your mother chased you around with a yardstick, but she never ever caught me, so I was grateful for that, but I remember those days myself.
You were a little brat, weren't you?
All right, moving on here, moving on.
Move on.
Is there any public comment?
Karen Shade, congratulations on the 72% success rate.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think the whole community hopes you go for 75 or higher. Is anyone achieving 80% success rate or higher levels still? And what are characteristics of what they are doing? And can any of that be implemented here?
Right off the top of my head, and I do see those, they send those reports out about every 6 months to try to let you look around those kind of things and compare yourself to other agencies that are like yours. There are some that are reaching 75%, but it's, I think the last time I looked, Karen, it was four agencies across state that had hit 75, and they were all significantly smaller districts than ours. And I'm not going to attribute that to being smaller, that they can do it, because if you apply the same practices, you should be able to hit that with any population you have. But they were all smaller than us. Agencies of like us are much lower than this rate, in the 60s as we were over the last few years. And I'm not bad-mouthing them either, because for us to climb out of the 60s was not an easy crawl.
Right. I located, going back to the final report for Saline County dated July 28th, 2011, from the National Institute of Corrections Jail and Justice System Assessment, that when they came out and did a lot with the sheriff's office, and you were a part of that, I believe, or
maybe.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
When
you said 2011, I was living in here, but I don't know. I think.
Okay.
Oh yeah, with Johnson.
Could be. I don't know.
Okay.
The summary suggests that Saline County has the opportunity to affect the rate of increase by taking an active role in determining on a system level how the jail and other sanctions will be used, meaning that you all could affect the rate of increase in the number of the population in the jail by taking an active role. And it suggests a system-wide review to look at streamlining things and an expansion of alternatives to jail, which give judges more options in sentencing and pre-trial release. Mm-hmm. And I go back to what I mentioned earlier, where it seems for those who look at the bookings, and I don't, a lot of parole violations, mm-hmm. that seems to be a preferred method or a frequent method used by the courts for getting those people's attention, and we as a consequence have a full jail. Are there things that stand out from this time period that were tried, that have been successful or weren't?
Mm-hmm. One of the things that the evidence research will show you is that a quick dip in jail is impactful to a client. So if the judge or community corrections or court services or state parole, you have to remember that when they list parole violators, they mean everybody that services clients. So it's not just community corrections, it's mm-hmm. all those agencies. But a quick dip in jail, 3 days, 48 hours, can be very, very impactful in reducing negative behavior and attitude in clients, especially those that have families, jobs, those kind of things. So that is research-based to show that it is effective. Longer-term jail terms are not impactful, in my opinion, nor do they make a difference. But what happens is that the judge would order maybe a 30 or 60-day sentence it's a sentence on a revocation. Instead of sending them to prison and revoking them and making them go to prison for years, they get that 30 days or 60 days, and then they get to come back out and have that. Can still be impactful, can make a difference, but we all know that, I've said it several times, you're in jail too many days, you lose everything you have. Mm-hmm. And so we try to avoid those. Other things that we have implemented recently that we're trying to do instead of jail days, except for those quick dips, we're still going to utilize those quick dips. Mm-hmm. Our electronic monitoring devices, where we can monitor them 24/7 with the GPS, daily reporting, a little more evening checks, so our surveillance is out until midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning. They may stop by two or three times on these people and check them. But also services. I mean, increasing their pro-social activities. So getting these clients to understand that instead of at 6 o'clock when you get off work, you go open a beer and smoke a joint, you instead go to the recovery center and spend time with recovering people, play pool, watch a movie, do something that's pro-social activities. So we're continually to look at those kind of things and make those things interesting for clients so that instead of their negative behavior and attitude, we're looking at more of a positive role. I agree with you. I don't like long-term jail sentences. I even dislike long-term prison sentences worse. Nothing happens. They're warehoused. Nothing gets attained from there. They come out nothing better. But those short-term dips are effective, and I do want to point that out.
And I just would come back to, this goes back to things discussed in July of 2011. And as a taxpayer, we kind of go, yes, I appreciate the small steps, but there really hasn't been a lot of funding for electronic bracelets. It's just a small amount, and you only serve, I believe it's fewer than five or so at a time.
Well, we have $13,000, and we haven't even utilized it all, but we're putting everybody on there that's applicable to it, and the judge is assigning people to it. I don't know. I think it's more than five, but I couldn't tell you. But, you know, you're right. The funding impacts that ability. Electronic monitoring is very expensive. And so for us to put someone on that and expect them to cover that cost on a daily basis just isn't realistic. So we have to find the funds for it. And, again, that's writing grants and finding those funds to service those pieces to keep them out of the jail or prison population.
I think it's worthy of public attention. Thanks.
Annie, thank you very much. Appreciate you coming by. We'll see. Are you coming this afternoon?
I am coming this afternoon. All right. Send Rosie, she's in jeans.
All right.
Oh, and Rick wants to be placed on the agenda sooner than that. All right.
Yeah, I could already.
I told him he's in my car, and I said, but I would say that. So I'm going to publicly say it.
All right.
All right. Thank you.
Getting on to item number 10.
Livestock and Expo update with Rick Lehmer.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
Good morning, Rick.
We've had a lot going on at the Expo Center past several months, so the best way to show you is just a slideshow. I can get to work. We've got the first Mid-America Farm Show. Had a lot of exhibitors this year. I think they said it was clear full. This is one of the events that we share with the Bicentennial Center. And all the exhibitors I talked to, they talked like it was a successful show. Everybody was happy with what they were selling. So,
you had good weather.
Yeah, it was perfect for a farm show. It's one of the seminars in 4-H building. I think they had four or five of them in there. Ag Hall. This is Salinas Sirens Practices. We have probably eight of these a month in Kenwood Hall. And then they have their bouts at the Buy Center. Spring Beef Show. This is a show that we started having again this year. It's kind of a pre-fair tune-up for 4-H kids and FFA members under 19 years old. I think they had about 70 head of cattle show up to
72.
That.
72, it was a record almost.
Yeah, it was a nice show.
Yeah.
55th Annual Mounted Patrol Rodeo. This is their yearly fundraiser at the Expo Center. They use the money to buy rescue equipment and for training. And they had a pretty good crowd. Yeah. That stock contractor had some pretty good bulls because they never did get one rode. This is
that was two nights.
Bob Thummel auction. Bob probably has about six auctions a month, and he attracts people from all over the state. He has a lot of antiques, things like that.
The one that same day that you had the Mounted Patrol and everything, it was there was 88 counties in the state of Kansas, and there was 26 states,
and
22 states.
And that was a very large auction that he
it was,
and
yeah,
it was nice.
It was a very nice auction.
This is a Tammy Walker Dance Benefit. Benefits Tammy Walker Cancer Center. very nice lady to work with. She has this event every year in the 4-H building. This was a first-time event. It was a miniature horse show and sale that we had last weekend. It was very successful. She went ahead and booked again for next year. And this is some visitors we had to our RV spot.
Oh, wow.
We had some tigers stay with us. They're actually leaving today because they were here the other night, and his wife said, we're getting out of here tonight. So they're actually leaving today. Very nice people. We'll talk to you all you want to talk about tigers. This is our schedule for May, kind of hard to read, but a couple highlights are we have a 4-day miniature horse show, and then we have a new 4-day Holstein show towards the end of the month there. And that's all I have for today.
Questions or comments?
Comment is they're doing a great job over there. I go to just about every event over there just to see. And I always check the tags. And it seems like the 4-day events is the only time that we get out of state. And that's kind of nice to see.
Yeah, and they come from all
over. They come from all over. I'll tell you what, they were from Arizona, California. They were from every state. There was 22 states in the parking lot over there, and they all drove here to buy.
And that's like that Holstein show. They're coming from Oklahoma, Nebraska. They're coming from all over.
Six states. Mm-hmm. And I was amazed at how many different counties were here. That was big. And I have a listing of every one of those counties. I got them from Bob, you know, on everybody that bought and everybody that registered there. It was pretty big.
Rick, thanks for coming today, and thanks for everything that you do.
Thank you.
Under other business, I just have a... go ahead.
I needed to talk to him after the meeting.
Oh, okay. Yeah, under other business, Don, I just had a question for you, if I could.
Sure.
And it came about with the recent mailing of the ballots.
Mm-hmm.
And in my situation, I got 3 sent to my house that don't obviously live there anymore. And we... how often are things purged, or are they ever purged?
In the election business, we don't use the word purge.
That's fair enough.
But to answer your question, though, you had 3 individuals who were not.
Right, and we've lived there 21 years, so this is at
least.
What's
happened is those 3 people have moved out wherever they've gone. And and if they've re-registered someplace else, and probably in another state, mm-hmm. because here in the state of Kansas, we are connected through the election voter information system. All 105 counties are connected. So if you move to Abilene or some other county in Kansas, it's a seamless process. But if you move out of state, you have to rely on the voter to say they were previously registered in a such and such address in Salina, Kansas, or Saline County, Kansas. That way, that information goes to their Secretary of State,
mm-hmm.
our Secretary of State, and then it's forwarded to us. And we get, typically about every day, we get information from our Secretary of State that they have moved to some other state. And then we can take them off. What we do when we get those ballots back like that is we send, if we have a forwarding address, we send them a card to say, it's what's called a confirmation card to confirm that are you in fact living in Columbia, Missouri, mm-hmm. and if they sign off and send that back, then we can take them off.
Mm-hmm.
But it's only at the voter's request.
Mm-hmm.
I realize those people are not there, but I can't just say okay they're gone because that's equal to me taking away their right to vote.
And it was just something.
So we're very careful about that. I appreciate knowing that, but. And that happens all over town, unfortunately.
Right. Well, and I guess my follow-up question would be, is we always talk about, complain about lower voter turnout.
Mm-hmm.
Those 3 not sending in their, obviously they can't send their form back in. And then we say, you know, only 20% voted in that. So
mm-hmm.
that number, the low voter turnout, maybe is a little exaggerated.
It is.
Okay.
Definitely. I mean, we have a lot of them up there. I don't know how many right now, but we have a whole bunch, I can tell you, that have come back to us, either have a forwarding address or no forwarding or whatever, and we don't know where they went. But
right. So 50% of the people send them back in, we know that the actual voter turnout was better than 50%.
That's correct, yes.
But it's hard to guess.
It's hard to know that for sure. We work very hard to keep those lists good and clean. We have one person, that's pretty much her job up there, is taking care of that. And so, yeah, I'd like to have a perfectly clean list, but it's hard.
And it'll never happen. I mean, no. The in-basket's going to always be full. So
I have a question. I've been looking at my mailbox every day. My wife and I haven't got our ballots yet.
You haven't?
No, and I talked to my neighbor this morning. He got his, like, Friday.
Yeah, last week.
Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, it'll surely be there yesterday. So I'm going to call home and see if she can check it for me. But
yeah, check on that, because you should have them by now.
Well, I would hope so, and I'm pretty upset that I don't have it, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How many other people, and that's why I waited until now to say it, are there other people out there that haven't got your ballots? We call into the commissioners and let them know. We need to know that people have a right to get to vote. I don't know that I like this mail-in ballot thing very well. I'd rather come right up here to the courthouse and vote during the month, you know.
We'll check into that, Commissioner. We'll follow up on it.
Mm-hmm. I definitely will, because it's not good.
Any other comments? Announcements? I will just make an announcement. We will reconvene at 1 o'clock upstairs for a short afternoon meeting, I believe. So is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.